Good morning. Welcome to the United Church of Christ in Boxborough. It is a delight to see so many of you here in the sanctuary, as well as to greet all of you on Zoom. We are delighted to provide hybrid worship, which is one in which our worship of God expands beyond time and space. Those who are here in this particular space, those who are in virtual space, and there may be those watching after the fact, which will expand our time. There's a way that God's love is so powerful. Indeed, it's beyond time and space. It is here in the present moment, and it is here in eternity. So welcome to this exquisite opportunity to gather together during this season of Lent, to praise God, to worship, and to be together with community of church. We have a song of celebration that we've been singing every week during Lent. And I'm challenging you once again. We're going to sing it in a four-part round. It's going to be really, really fun. So Glennis and I are going to lead this side of the church. And whoever's in the front half, follow me. And whoever's in the back half, follow Glennis. We'll be sitting there at the time. And then whoever's in the front half of this side, follow Marley. And whoever's in the back half of that side, including my tech team, follow Gloria. And we're going to sing it in unison once, and then we're going to sing it twice in a four-part round, and we will just see what happens. So Joe's just going to keep playing. So even if it's a train wreck, the organ will keep playing. So thank you for amusing your pastor with your musical skill. I want to thank Marley Roberts for covering with the choir, and we celebrate that Cindy Blanchard is enjoying a week of vacation. And A Holiday to Remember is a film about Alzheimer's. I first learned about it from the Reverend Betsy Sowers in November, and it's taken us this long to pull together a program. So we'll have a chance to grab a quick cup of coffee after worship, and if you're interested in seeing this six-minute film and having some discussion about dementia and Alzheimer's, we'll be gathering in this front section of the church for and that is both on Zoom as well as in person. So I encourage you to attend that if you would like. Then I wanted to mention that Monday is the Color of Compromise. The Racial Justice Team is offering these conversations to learn more about how we can be an anti-racist community. And we're looking forward to the guided Boston walking tour on Black History, which will be April 21st. And that's with the Reverend June Cooper, who is just a fabulous leader. And you may speak with Tinica in coffee hour, or you may sign up online. There's information in the Friday flash. Wanted to remind you that Easter flower orders are due this week. So you can either see Laurel today or sign up, talk to the church office or sign up online. And Wednesday is the last meeting of the table. We've had a lovely Wednesday evening program with our Acton Boxborough UCC churches. And this Wednesday at 6:30, come for soup and bread and good conversation at South Acton Congregational Church. That's Wednesday at 6:30. You can sign up online. And I would like to ask Glennis to come and share with us some exciting event that we're looking forward to on Saturday.
Good morning. So our second UCCB vegetarian vegan potluck supper is this Saturday, and very few people have signed up. So I want to encourage you to either sign up on the flash or send me email, or you can speak to me after church. And if you can't think of what to bring, it doesn't have to be a main dish, although we had some fabulous main dishes last time. I'm bringing potatoes. If you've got a favorite green bean recipe, or maybe one of those southwestern salads, that would be fabulous. Or you don't have to bring anything at all. Just come and enjoy the fellowship and some great food. So Saturday at 6 p.m. in the community center. Hope to see you there.
Glennis, do we have any entertainment that evening?
Oh, of course. How could I forget the entertainment? So Reverend Cindy, it'll be one of your last opportunities. Did you have a few stories you were going to tell?
I'll
let you.
I do.
Yes.
Caring for the world.
Yes.
Few stories
so
about caring
you don't
for
want
the
to
world.
Miss that either. Thank you, Cindy.
Thank you, Glennis. And let us continue our worship in music.
Please join with me in the call to worship found in your bulletin. I have to approve, make sure Ralph approves of that. Is that okay, Ralph? The journey of Lent continues with a journey of sacrifice.
We are called upon to give our lives to God.
We are called upon to give of ourselves to others.
Lord, help us to reach in word and in confession and outward in service.
Be with us this day and walk with us on this journey.
Amen.
Let us join together in the gathering hymn, Lord Jesus, who through 40 days. Please join me in the reading of the unison prayer of confession, which we will follow with a moment of silence for you to address your individual prayers. Rainbow God, you created all people in your image. You fashioned our bodies, infused our spirits, and placed the imprint of your love in our hearts. The full view of humanity requires a global perspective, a welcoming presence, and an affirming connection to all people everywhere. Creator God, forgive us when we stumble into prejudice based on race or ethnicity or language. Forgive our awkward conversation and give us courage to broaden our view. Heal us from the brokenness of racism and ignite in us a curiosity to expand our circle of friends and neighbors with diversity and community. Queer loving God, forgive us when we see gender in a limited binary way. Expand our experience of gender as fluid, playful, truthful. We confess that we sometimes see a heterogeneous world. Show us the beauty and the power and the diversity of LGBTQ people and families. Cast out our internalized homophobia. Transform our internalized racism. Renew us that we might love ourselves and each other with the power of your love. Amen. Dearly beloved, you are precious and beautiful just as you are. God created you with love. May God's healing hand be upon each of you and all of us together in beloved community. Amen. We invite you to greet each other online or through online through Zoom, chat box, or in person with a wave, a bow, a high five. We'll conclude with the passing of the peace with our song of celebration and look for your team leader. May peace be with you.
Well done, church. And you on Zoom were just singing along while muted. Thank you. Look at, oh. So yesterday I went into Dunkin' Donuts to buy some coffee, and the barista was wearing a scarf with shamrocks and shamrock earrings and shamrocks in her hair and green eyeshadow and little leprechaun pointy ears and a headband just like this. And she said that she was not working today on Sunday, which is why she was dressed on Saturday. But I decided I needed to share this lovely little tradition with you. So we have here a shamrock. I want you to see that it's sparkly, a little bit of bling. And it goes like the, what do you think? You on Zoom, what do you think? So there's lots to talk about St. Patrick's Day. And one of the things I wanted to lift up is in line with the history of St. Patrick. He's the patron saint in Ireland, and he lived so long ago that there's as much tradition, more tradition than there is history, but it's clear that he was active in the 5th century. In Ireland as a Christian missionary, and indeed he was the first bishop of the Christian church in Ireland in that fabulous, just incredible history of Christianity in Ireland. Less frequently discussed is that there are a number of bishops in that 5th century, and his nephew ordained one whose name was Brigid of Kildare. She was also a bishop in the church. In those days, an abbot or an abbess would be in charge of a monastery, which was often co-educational,
It was very typical for priests in those days to marry. Many of them had children, and there was a sense of men and women leading together in the church in the 5th century and on. It was only once, well, I won't go into that history. Anyway, let's stay in the 5th century. As I understand it, there were extraordinarily feminist laws in Ireland, and women had the right to own property, to be protected from any kind of violence or abuse, to sue for divorce in case of violence, and to be educated. And so at the time of St. Patrick, there was also St. Bridget in this lovely sharing of men and women in leadership. So as a woman in ministry, I just wanted to celebrate St. Patrick's Day with that little bit of history that you may not get at Dunkin' Donuts from your barista wearing shamrocks. And just to add to that some biblical history, there's been recent scholarship about Mary Magdalene, that she indeed was a leader and an apostle. And there's some belief that at the time of Jesus' resurrection, it was really Peter and Mary leading the church. So I just want to share with you how deep our roots of equality between and among genders are, and celebrate St. Patrick's Day. So top of the morning to you, laddies and lassies. Why don't we pray? Gracious God, we give you thanks for St. Patrick and all that he brought to Ireland in terms of the love of Jesus. And we also thank you for the many women, abbesses and bishops with whom he worked. And we thank you for the partnership of women and men in leadership in communities of faith throughout the world and throughout history. Amen.
I want to give you a little context for this song, which is a song I wrote after hybrid worship. In February of 2023, I've been incredibly grateful for hybrid worship all these years. And sometimes I still have a little trouble, though, bringing myself centered and focusing, especially when there's a lot going on in my head. And on this particular morning, the lesson was from Genesis 2:7, which is God taking dust and blowing breath into it. And the song is called Ruach, which is means both breath and spirit in Hebrew. So our other beloved Reverend Cindy had started to preach, and somebody in the chat sent out a heartfelt prayer for her mother, who was really, really sick. And suddenly four of us fired off prayers into the chat box. And in that moment, I just was suddenly really fully back in church. And I also had this realization that church wasn't just on Zoom, it was in all of us, as was the Spirit. There was dust, then a breath, and the Spirit came. There was grief, then a hug, and it did the same. God in us moving as we move to. May God's breath fill our hearts and all we do. There was dark and then light,
When the angels came, there was fear and then friends, and they did the same. God in us moving as we move to. May God's breath fill our hearts and all we do. All around us and above, moving in us, breath of love. There were crowds and then loaves, and the feeding came. There was pain and a prayer, and it did the same. God in us moving as we move to. May God's breath fill our hearts and all we do. May God's breath fill our hearts and all we do.
I'd like to share with you the scripture this morning, which is from the book of Romans, chapter 8, 31 to 39, and it goes like this. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? God, who gave God's only Son for us, how will God fail to give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, who was raised, yes, who is seated at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. As it is written, they, for your sake, we are being killed all day long. We are like sheep to be slaughtered. I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor rulers, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Here ends the telling of God's blessed word. Thanks be to God. Please join me in a spirit of prayer. Loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The Apostle Paul sets forth these words as a promise, as an encouragement, as a word of hope in times that were desperate, as a way to give strength and courage to those who may feel downtrodden. He says that nothing is beyond God's love and care and protection and might. Not famine, not nakedness, not violence by sword. Can we say assault weapons today? There's nothing, not poverty, not homelessness, not hunger, not sorrow, not living with cancer, not struggling with mental illness, not having learning disabilities. Nothing is beyond the love of God. Whatever we think about God, God is more. Whatever power of love we think we know about the Spirit, it is more. Whatever sense we have of Jesus reaching into lives and touching and changing and transforming people, it is more. There is a way that in this poetry of Scripture, Paul, who, by the way, was among the most virulent anti-Christian Pharisees ever. He was the one who was putting the early Christians in prison, rounding them up because that they were professing a resurrection of Jesus Christ, which was not in line with his understanding of the religion of the day. And he was touched by God in such a way that he became a follower of Jesus Christ himself. And it's just remarkable. And I my experience of talking and working with Christians of all different persuasions and theologies, and there's something about a person who has been way, way down in the depths of the wrong direction, who gets turned, who speaks with a lot of power. And then there are others of us who move toward Jesus little by slow, who have a sense of spirituality as a process, who consider a wide variety of spiritual blessings while keeping our feet grounded in the Jesus Christ of our love. There's room for all of that in church, all different ways of understanding the love of Christ, the power of God, and this extraordinary gift that no matter what humanity does to strike violence into God's own heart, which is what happened on the cross, God still loves us. God raises Jesus. Jesus walks with us. It's really amazing. And I worry that we're so used to seeing this cross that we've sort of lost the power of it. Oh yeah, that means Christian. It means, whoa! It's that sense of a little kid looking at a rainbow for the first time. I may have told this story before, but we have a Joys and Concerns in the church where I was serving over a decade ago. And there was a moment when a little four-year-old raised her hand. And I asked if she had a joy or a concern. And she had a joy. She said, "God showed us a rainbow in the parking lot." It was just so clear. And the whole congregation was like, whoa, right? Not only the idea of God creating rainbows, but the idea of a community giving voice to a very young, small person to speak to that beauty of God's love. What a blessing. You know, there's so much negativity in the world around us, and there's such a sense of competition amongst our young people and amongst our adults, and such a sense of perfectionism, and all of that can drive down that sense of awe and wonder. And so in the church, we have an opportunity to reclaim that childlike amazement, the wow part of prayer, to invite God to surprise us again and again and again, and to trust no matter what. My friends, God has your back. And if you're in a moment where it doesn't seem like that, that's why we are a whole people here in the sanctuary and on Zoom, because there's going to be at least one person here who remembers it for you and prays on your behalf. We are not individual, isolated spiritual journeyers. We are the body of Christ in a church. And no matter how difficult moments in the journey are, nothing will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. My dad sang. He was 7 years old and sang as a boy soprano in the boys choir at the Episcopal Cathedral in Paterson, New Jersey. He sang in the high school chorus. He sang in the glee club at the University of Rochester. And he sang in every church choir of whatever church he belonged to throughout his adult life. When he retired, he sang in the Eastman Chorus. The Eastman School of Music had a PhD for conductors, and part of how they taught students to conduct is that their professor created this community chorus. So in the chorus were community members, but also conducting students. And while the conductor conducted, he taught the students in the chorus how to conduct. It was a remarkable experience. My dad, every Tuesday, was at the Eastman Chorus. I had just begun my storytelling ministry, and I was in need of some encouragement, not quite sure if the storytelling piece was going to work well, but I did have a presentation to do on this particular year on Easter Monday. It was at a nursing home in Rochester, New York, where I knew the chaplain, and he got me this job. And so I went to Rochester to spend Easter weekend with my family so that I could do this presentation. And I'm sitting in the living room with my dad, and my dad says to me, "Cindy, I have some really bad news." And I said, "What is it, Dad?" He said, "Well, it seems that I may have Alzheimer's disease." Now, I knew this because 2 hours earlier I had sat in the kitchen at the table with my mom and my dad, and together they had told me, but Dad forgot. I said, "Dad, what will it be like for you?" We sat quietly for a few moments, and then this question came to me: what will it be like for you, do you think, as you go through Alzheimer's? My dad thought a minute and he said, "Well, I know that over time I'll lose words, and then I'll lose sentences and phrases, you know, that ability to tie thoughts together, and then I think in my mind I'll lose any kind of rational, logical thinking. And as I lose that bit by bit, I think what will fill my brain will be Bach, Beethoven, and Mozart, until the only language I know is music." Monday came, and I went to the nursing home and did a presentation, you know, the scripture story and song that I tend to do. And my mom was sitting in the second row. She was just hanging on every word, giving me all this encouragement with her face. And my dad was standing in the back, staring out into space, not really even in the room. Well, we had a Q&A session afterwards, and so people asked different questions about the stories, and I was sharing with them, and my mom had a bunch of questions and answers to share too, and it was all very lovely. My dad was staring out the window. Not even there, I don't think. We had refreshments after, chocolate chip cookies, and do you know those lemon squares? They have shortbread and a little lemon filling and some confectioner sugar on top. They had those, and some Hawaiian punch. And we got ready to go, and I had a big heavy wool coat, and I went to the coat rack, and my dad was there, and I reached for my coat, and he reached in front of me, and he took the coat and he held it up, and I put one arm into it and then the other arm, and kind of shrugged into it as he pulled it up on my shoulders, because my dad was the kind of man who would always put a coat on for a lady, right? He always did that. And I got the coat on, and I almost forgot for a minute about his Alzheimer's, you know, and I turned to him, and just like regular, I said, "So, Dad, what did you think about the storytelling?" And all of a sudden, there was light in his eyes, and he looked at me, and he said, "I was in the back." I said, "You were?" "Well, I wanted to jump up and say to everyone, that's my daughter. But I didn't." And I laughed, and he laughed, and we headed home. And he sat in the chair and did his Sudoku, which is what he did. No longer were there piles of New Yorker magazines and engineering record, just piles of Sudoku and some coloring books. And I learned something that day about the moment of grace. I wondered what would have happened if I'd grabbed my coat and then gone to talk to the chaplain, leaving my dad there. I wondered what kind of grace it was that gave me that focus and attention. And what I learned in the years that followed until my dad's death was that there were moments in the present, not yesterday, not tomorrow, just this cup of coffee here, that painting my grandfather painted on the wall right here, whether it was raining outside that window right here. It was a gift of the present moment. And despite the fact that there was a separation from my dad in the way I had always known him, and then that final terrible separation of death, nothing could separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing could separate us. Amen. Let us sing "What Wondrous Love Is This." Please be seated. We have the opportunity to share joys and concerns in our community of faith. You may put them in the chat box or share them here in the sanctuary. Do we have joys or concerns this morning? Yes, Ginny. Welcome, Pat and Gordon. Good to have you home.
And And we once had a dance, and I brought the dance.
We praise God for singing and dancing and memories and old friends gathering together. Thank you. Who else? Yes, Pat, please.
I would like to say that in June, it will be 50 years since you married.
Happy 50th anniversary coming up in June. The old sanctuary right this way. That's wonderful. Praise God. Yes. Happy birthday, Lindsay. Wonderful. Others, yes, Mary. It is a really great joy to hear baby voices in the sanctuary today. Peter. Welcome, Terry. Good to have you here. And we celebrate new friends visiting, and we also celebrate our relationship between our congregational churches, UCC churches in the area. It's wonderful. Marley.
Well, I'm
going
to celebrate with Mary.
Oh, dear. That would be two for baby voices. Kelly. We praise God for Tinica's beautiful song, the gift of music, the gift of composition, and really the testimony to how it is that God has worked through hybrid worship in a really difficult time during pandemic shutdown. That's just a beautiful, beautiful song and a beautiful sentiment. Thank you. Gloria. We celebrate our Music Sunday concert last week, all that participated in the diversity of music and styles and language. It was just a real gift, real gift. Thank you, Gloria, for your leadership in that. Yes, Damon. Damon, soon to graduate from Neshoba Valley Tech. Praise God, praise God. And let's hold all seniors everywhere in our prayers this spring. Oh, so close to the finish line. Yeah, yeah, so close as yet so far. Suzanne, did I see your hand? Yeah. We praise God for Colin's birthday on Thursday and continue to hold him in prayer in his wonderful missionary work in Paraguay, and also celebrate William's promotion and what wonderful success that is in the presence of his former teacher. It's lovely to see how over the years our community continues to be present one to the other. Thank you, Suzanne. Any other, yes, Nicolette. More birthdays, Nicolette's brother, Anthony, and Larry's sister, Barb, had a birthday on Friday. Yes. Yes. Heidi.
I have a few on chat.
Yes, please.
Celebrating her mother's 90th birthday.
I'm sorry, tell me the first name. Who's... Trist is celebrating their mother's birthday, 90 years old and still driving.
Another celebration is Larry, his stepson, Chad, just got engaged.
Oh, Larry's stepson, Chad, just got engaged. We praise God for that. Please pray for, say that again.
A prayer for my ex-husband and caregiver who might be facing a cancer.
She says ex-husband and caregiver may be facing a diagnosis of cancer. So hold that situation in your prayers, please. Yes, Laurel. Sam and Lauren have a 7-month-old daughter, and it's Lauren who has brain cancer. They're in Colorado. Please hold them in prayer. Other celebrations or joys or concerns this morning? Yes, Nicolette. And please pray for Ginny and Ian, who have both been struggling with health issues this week, that God's healing hand would be on them. Let us join together in prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the gift of life. We give you thanks for the children present in our midst and for 90-year-old birthdays. We give you thanks for 50th wedding celebrations and job promotions and graduation just around the corner. We give you thanks for all of this life and living. We give you thanks for new friends here in our midst, as well as old friends come back. We give you thanks for teachers who can see the success of students many years past. We pray that you would bless all of those living with Alzheimer's and Parkinson's and any kind of neurological difficulty. We pray for those who are caregivers to those with dementia. We pray for those who are living with cancer and those who are living with any kind of mental illness, and that you would bless those who struggle with depression or anxiety. We pray that you would be in all of the classrooms with teachers and aides and substitute teachers. We pray that you would be present in places where there are those who are in need of housing and good food. We pray that you would bring your spirit of peace into places of strife and violence. And we would ask you to grace us with your love as we seek to see the world more clearly through your eyes, the way that we might see people with your love, the way we might find a breath of forgiveness in your presence. Lord, we ask you to bless us and keep us and shine your light upon us. Help us to do your work in this world and help us to release ourselves to your love, to feel that light within ourselves. We ask you to grace this particular community of church, and that you would bless us in the work that we are to do, the community that we enjoy, the good food that we share, the exchange of ideas, the singing that we do, that all of our experience and community here at UCC Boxborough would be blessed by your power and your love and your gentle grace. We pray as Jesus taught, saying, Holy Spirit, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. One of the many ways we give thanks to God is with our generosity. And so every time we gather for worship, we have an opportunity to give a portion of what we have, our gifts, our tithes, our offerings, to support the ministry of the church and the mission of the wider church. Let us receive that offering at this time. Thank you.
pray in the name of Christ our Savior.
May you know hope in the midst of doubts, assurance in times of questioning, and peace in the presence of conflict. May your journey through Lent lead you ever closer to the heart of God, and may God walk with you all your days. Amen. Thank you.